Welcome to Top Misfit. On today's episode, we'll be celebrating the nerds, the rebels, and the misunderstood as we count down our top picks for inspiring speeches in a teen movie. So, grab your pitchforks, sit back, and let's get motivated. Number 8. Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
Life moves pretty fast. You don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
If we're talking about teen movies, then it's only right to kickstart our list with a John Hughes classic. Ferris Bueller is the king of mischief as he attempts to take a day off without getting caught. Although Ferris is the star of the movie, the true character development happens within Cameron. Cameron must find the courage to confront his father about the wrecked car. As a result, Cameron gives a short yet passionate speech about taking back control of his life.
You gotta take a stand against him. I am not gonna sit on my ass as the events that affect me unfold to determine the course of my life. I'm gonna take a stand. I'm gonna defend it. Right or wrong, I'm gonna defend it.
Number 7, Accepted.
South Harmon, we say yes to you. We say yes to your hopes. We say yes to your dreams. We say yes to your flaws. So welcome.
Some would agree that Accepted sits comfortably on a long list of underrated teen movies. With early appearances from Jonah Hill, Blake Lively, and Justin Long, this film is a gem in a sea of teen comedies. After being rejected by all the colleges he applies to.
If you want to be somebody, you go to college. If you want to fit in, you go to college.
Well, you know what? Maybe I didn't get into college.
Barnaby and his friends transform an abandoned mentor institution into a fake college to trick their parents. Things quickly escalate when they discover their fake website is not only active, but has accepted a flock of paying students who turn up ready for orientation. Although Barnaby plans to turn them away, he has a change of heart. Instead, he decides to provide the ultimate college experience, one that puts the students' dreams first. The college is exposed as a fake, and Barnaby stands up to defend his students, challenging the board members as he fights for his school to be taken seriously.
What about you, parents? Did the system really work out for you? Did it teach you to follow your heart or to just play it safe, roll over? What about you guys? Did you always want to be school administrators? Dr. Alexander, was that your dream? Or maybe no, maybe you wanted to be a poet. Maybe you want to be a magician or an artist. Maybe you just wanted to travel the world. Look, I lied to you. I lied to all of you, and I'm sorry, Dad, especially to you. But out of that desperation, something happened that was so amazing. It was full of possibilities, and isn't that what you ultimately want for us as parents? I mean, is possibilities. Well, we came here today to ask for your approval, and something just occurred to me. I don't give a shit. Who cares about your approval? We don't need your approval to tell us that what we did was real. Because there are so few truths in this world that when you see one, you know it. And I know that it is a truth that real learning took place at South Harmon. Whether you like it or not, it did. Because you don't need teachers or classrooms or fancy highbrow traditions or money to really learn. You just need people with a desire to better themselves. And we got that by the shitload at South Harmon. So you can go ahead, sign your forms, reject us and shoot us down and do whatever you gotta do. It doesn't really matter at this point because we'll never stop learning and we'll never stop growing and we'll never forget the ideals that were instilled in us at our place because we are shitheads now and we'll be shitheads forever and nothing you can say or do or stamp can take that away from us, so grow!
Number 6. Perks of Being a Wallflower.
You see things and you understand. You're a wallflower.
In this golden coming of age, Charlie, a nervous introvert, teaches us the emotional ups and downs of being a wallflower. Charlie begins high school and struggles to fit in. He attracts the attention of high school seniors and social outcasts Sam and her stepbrother Patrick.
You could write about us?
Yeah. Call it Slut and the Falcon. Make us solve crimes.
The two free spirits introduce Charlie to a new world. As Charlie's feelings for Sam grows, and his new friends prepare to go off to college, past pains from Charlie's childhood begin to resurface. Despite his wounds, Charlie gives an enlightening speech about appreciating life and its moments.
I am here, and I am looking at her, and she is so beautiful. I can see it. This one moment when you know you're not a sad story. You are alive. And you stand up and see the lights on the buildings and everything that makes you wonder. And you're listening to that song on that drive with the people you love most in this world. And in this moment, I swear, we are infinite.
Number 5, Stand By Me.
Knife that one, you cheap dime store hood.
Adding another classic to our list, Stand By Me tells the tale of four boys that go looking for a dead body.
You guys want to go see a dead body?
Throughout the journey, the boys run from trains, dogs, and local bullies, growing an authentic bond that captures the essence of brotherhood. Jordy mourns the loss of his brother and lack of love he gets from his parents, while Chris struggles with the pressure and unfair treatment he gets for being the younger brother to the local bully. Chris displays his maturity as he encourages Jordy to appreciate the gift he was given.
You could be a real writer someday, Gordy. Fuck writing! I don't want to be a writer. It's stupid. It's a stupid waste of time.
That's your dad talking.
You're just a kid, Gordy. Oh, gee, thanks, Dad. Wish the hell I was your dad. You wouldn't be going around talking about taking these stupid shop courses if I was. It's like God gave you something, man. All those stories that you can make up. And he said, this is what we got for you, kid. Try not to lose it. But kids lose everything unless there's someone there to look out for them. And if your parents are too fucked up to do it, then maybe I should.
Number 4, The Breakfast Club.
When you grow up, your heart dies.
Who cares?
I care.
Yet another John Hughes classic to grace this list. The Breakfast Club is famous for many reasons, from the legendary cast to iconic soundtrack. This movie marks an important part in teen movie history. 5 students from different social groups are forced to spend a Saturday in detention together, where they slowly reveal secrets, harsh truths, and come to learn they're not so different after all. Despite being told to each write an essay, describing who they think they are, at the end of the day, Brian is chosen to write a single letter for all of them, and in this letter, Brian iconically answers Mr. Vernon's question.
We accept the fact that we had to sacrifice a whole Saturday in detention for whatever it was we did wrong. But we think you're crazy to make us write an essay telling you who we think we are. And you see us as you want to see us. In the simplest terms, with the most convenient definitions. But what we found out is that each one of us is a brain. And an athlete.
And a basket case. A princess.
And a criminal. Does that answer your question? Sincerely yours, The Breakfast Club.
Number 3, Pump Up the Volume.
One day I woke up and I realized I was never going to be normal. So I said, fuck it. I said, so be it.
In this 90s flick, Christian Slater plays Mark Hunter, awkward teen by day and radio rebel by night. What starts off as a frequency of rants and pent-up frustration becomes much more when Harry receives a desperate call from a depressed boy who later ends his life.
Look, maybe it's okay to be alone sometimes. I mean, everybody's alone.
You're not.
Mark's show becomes a therapeutic platform for teenage pain, causing an uproar from his young listeners.
Make them think you might snap.
They think you got attitude, you show them some real attitude.
I be going nuts! Get crazy! Hey! No more Mr. Nice Guy!
Despite being hunted by the police, Harry comes out of hiding to make a passionate yet comforting speech to his listeners, encouraging them to hang on as things will only get better.
We're all worried. We're all in pain. That comes with having eyes and with having ears. But just remember one thing. It can't get any worse. It can only get better. I mean, high school is the bottom. Being a teenager sucks, but that's the point. Surviving it is the whole point. Quitting is not going to make you strong. Living will.
Number 2, Dead Poets Society.
No matter what anybody tells you, words and ideas can change the world.
Paying tribute to the late Robin Williams, Mr. Keating is an unorthodox professor at a prestigious boys' school.
Kick at it, beat it, it'll never cover any of us. From the moment we enter crying to the moment we leave dying, it'll just cover your face as you wail and cry and scream.
He sets out to motivate his students to think for themselves. From their first lesson, Mr. Keating boldly goes against the assigned curriculum, inspiring these young men to look at their lives from a new perspective.
Captain, my captain.
He inspires them to seize the day and leave their mark in this powerful play called life.
O me, O life, of the questions of these recurring, of the endless trains of the faithless, of cities filled with the foolish, what good amid these, O me, O life? Answer, that you are here, that life exists and identity. That the powerful play goes on and you may contribute a verse.
That brings us to number 1, Coach Carter.
Teachers ain't supposed to touch students.
I'm not a teacher. I'm the new basketball coach.
Samuel Jackson's inspiring voice shouts through our number 1 pick as he fights to not only make a group of young men winners on the basketball court, but also winners in life. But rebellious player Cruz puts up the biggest fight as he struggles with his street life and his potential to be more than his surroundings.
I got you.
Cruz realizes he wants a different future for himself, boldly standing up in front of his team to answer Coach Carter's recurring question, what is your deepest fear?
Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We were all meant to shine as children do. It's not just in some of us, it's in everyone. And as we let our own light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same, as we are liberated from our own fear. Our presence automatically liberates others.
What was your favorite teen speech? Comment down below any movies you think we missed. And don't forget to hit that subscribe button. Sayonara, Misfits. We'll see you in our next video.
Oh, and in case I don't see you, good afternoon, good evening, and good night.
Thanks for watching.